rock and roll here. This time I'd like to call Rockingham County Board of Commissioners regular meeting to order. It'd be July 10th, 2012. Also, if you've got a cell phone, if you would, put it on vibrate or cut it off, please. It's one thing that we like to do. At this time, if you'd like to stand with me, the invocation will be done by our county manager, and the Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Commissioner Travis.
Please join me in bowing our heads for a word of prayer. Listen to a sermon that included an excellent verse on Sunday that reminded me of how those in authority should make decisions. The words were found in Philippians chapter 3, verses 3 and 4, which reads as follows. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of the others. Father, please let our leaders remember the words that were so eloquently conveyed through Philippians and make good solid decisions for the entire populace, and let them know that you will be their comfort in making such decisions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Again, I'd like to welcome everybody. It looks like we've got a full house. If we need any extra seats, we can certainly get tinkering them to add a few more. Again, welcome the media as well. At this time, we're down to item four, which is the approval of the agenda. And commissioners, y'all had time to review the July 10, 2012 agenda. Is there any comments, questions, or anything concerning the agenda?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would like to respectfully request that we table item 10A, the adoption of the resolution of the declining privatization of the Rockingham County landfill. My rationale for doing so is back on April 23rd, let me pass this to you, we all unanimously agreed, I think there's one for each of us, to contract with Gershman, Breckner, and Bratton to evaluate the Rockingham County landfill. Our cost for doing this was almost $90,000. I would certainly like to get that information back, digested, and hopefully maybe even schedule a public hearing before we make any decisions on this landfill.
Is that all, Commissioner?
Yes, it is.
Is there any other discussion? Commissioner Travis?
I understand Commissioner Bass's concern, but my thoughts are, if we've been talking about this thing long enough, and I'm about tired of thinking about it, so I'm ready to proceed, and let's go ahead and make a decision on it tonight.
Commissioner Callie?
Mr. Chairman, I feel like we have looked into this matter and considered it, and it's been worked over in this county in many ways and fashion and form. And so far, I've seen it do absolutely no good to do this. I think we need to move forward with it and go ahead and show that we do have a solidarity in our county, and so the citizens of our county will know exactly where we're coming from.
We have one last comment.
Commissioner Bass, go right ahead.
Thank you. In keeping with the words that I think our county manager just shared with us, it's extremely important that we base our decision as leaders on factual information, not emotions. If we're going to spend $89,000 of the taxpayers' money, I think we ought to be able to give them an intelligent reason for whatever it is we're supporting. I'm tired of many things, but I was elected to make decisions as a representative of the 90 plus 93 plus thousand citizens of this county. So if we choose to go forward and not benefit from that information that we've asked and contracted for, so be it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Bass. The only thing I'd like to comment concerning that is that the $89,000 that Gresham, Brickner, and Batten, this evaluation that we voted unanimously to have done, we'll continue. And we're going to get that report. It's important that we get that report, because in that report is going to give us information of the longevity of our landfill as it is based on what we're putting in, the tonnage we're putting in now. It'll have in that report of if we should add 1,000 ton a day to our landfill, what is the longevity of that. That report will also include the equipment that we're currently using, the compaction rate that we are currently doing. It's going to have a ton of information that is going to be valuable to future boards beyond us and future generations beyond us. So the $89,000 that we're spending is $89,000 for generations ahead, and information that we valuably need. As Mr. Wells said in our last meeting, where we have tapped into the methane portion of it and spent a lot of time and money getting grants and so forth, and Mark Wells has done an outstanding job in doing that, and actually where the county can make $200,000 or $300,000 a year off his sell-off of electricity back to the grid coming off the methane that is produced in the landfill. So to say that that the landfill is not a extremely valuable asset to the financial stability of Rockingham County and to the people of Rockingham County, and citizens and future citizens and people of Rockingham County, would be an understatement. That is a valuable piece of real estate, and we are making money on it. Annually, it comes out around $2.75 to around $3 million a year. But that's what we have to make off of it anyway to put back in reserve for post-closure and for anything that happens out there, that we have to take that land up and land and have to clean it and stuff like that. It's mandated by the state. So that's something that we've got to do. So that is a very, very valuable piece of property. And until this landfill mess got started back in March of 11, March of 11, or February of 11, I didn't realize how valuable trash was. I didn't know I was throwing millions of dollars away every day when they come and got my trash.
Mr. Chairman, if we are going to discuss, could we call for the question?
Sure, we sure can.
I just want to make one comment, Mr. Chairman.
Just as soon as I get through, we'll be glad to do that. The portion of it that I appreciate is all the work's been done in the years, and all the future work is going to be available for the landfill out there, for our landfill. And if it wasn't so valuable, why does everybody want it? So at this time, I'll conclude my comments. Commissioner Travis has got...
I just want to make a clarification. Mr. Bass talked about we spending $89,000, but it ain't the taxpayers' money we spent. It was the enterprise fund from the landfill money that was spent. So none of the tax dollars were spent on that. It all came out of the landfill enterprise fund. Am I correct on that, Lance?
Yes.
Thank you.
Commissioner Cowell.
I think it's beneficial in every respect and every holy that we can send a message to the people in this county and let them and every citizen who is listening that can read and write and listen know where we stand as a governing body and how we're going to affect them and back up the citizens of our county and what they want. And that's precisely what we're here to do, is to support the people in this county, because we're elected by the people in this county to do that job. Thank you.
Well, at this time, I'll entertain a motion to leave it on or take it off.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for approval of the July 10th agenda as is.
All right, I have a motion for the approval of the July 10th agenda as it is written. Do I have a second?
I second it, sir.
Have a motion and second for the approval of the July 10, 2012 agenda as written. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise?
Aye.
Got one opposed. Motion carried. The approval of the agenda is done. At this time, we get down to item five, where it's the consent agenda. And we explained those in a little bit longer detail than what's written in your agenda that you have. And so I'll go over them on what they are. The consent agenda items for tonight is 5A is the approval of the minutes for the May 29 and June 12, 2012 meeting. 5B is the approval of the sheriff's office to convey a used portable x-ray machine, which it no longer uses, to the Greensboro Police Department for its bomb squad. 5C is the approval of a resolution to declare surplus and convey three stretchers to the Rockingham Community College. The three surplus, I may not get this word right, Stryker stretchers will be used by the Rockingham Community College in its EMS training program. The stretchers are no longer suitable for the county's use because of their age. And 5D is the approval of the resolution for the financing of two fire trucks by the Yanceyville Road Volunteer Fire Department. And in that, the Yanceyville Road Volunteer Fire Department is proposing to purchase and finance a 1998 KME pumper truck and a 2005 KME pumper tanker truck to use for its fire protection in their district. In order for such financing to be carried out at a favorable tax-exempt rate, the county approval is required. The amount financed is $185,000 at an interest rate of 2.63 for a 7-year term. The lender is BB&T. Yanceyville Road Volunteer Fire Department held its required public hearing to approve the purchase and financing on June 14, 2012 at 7 o'clock, and it had completed all the necessary forms required by BB&T for the transaction. Is there any discussion concerning the consent agenda? If not, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
Mr. Chairman, with your permission, sir, and grace, I'd like to seek approval and make the motion for approval of the consent agenda as read.
Okay, I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda. Do I have a second?
You do.
I have a second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed likewise? Okay. That's been approved. At this time, we get down to item six, the public comment period. And I know that several of you who have signed up have donated your time to Mr. Harrington. And so we'll know who has donated their time. Of course, there's a 15-minute max. If it needs a little more, you know, we sort of let that go because you got plenty of folks here. But I'm gonna call your name out, and if you wish to convey your 3 minutes to Mr. Harrington, just say yes, and I'll check you off. Monk?
Yes.
Mr. Witt?
Yes.
John Edwards?
Yeah.
Want to get Eugene Fuqua?
Mr. Chairman.
And Tommy's got three.
Yes, sir.
Had you finished your list?
Well, I've got four, and Tommy gets three anyway, so that makes it...
Okay, I was going to ask you if you would have them stand, because I really don't know where the sounds are coming.
Okay, Monk, if you'd stand, Mr. Edwards and Mr. Witt and Eugene Fuqua, would you stand, please? All right, that's four, and then Tommy gets three, which would be five, which would be the 15 minutes. Now, anybody, what about Georgia?
Here.
Grays?
Here.
Okay, do you want to speak, or are you donating your time?
I want to speak.
Okay, all right, just one of them. Norma, Kelly?
I'm donating my time.
Regina?
I donate my time to Mr. Harrington.
Could she stand? I don't see where that's coming from.
Yeah. Norma and Regina? Okay. Mabel Scott, you've got something else you want to talk about, I'm sure. Bobby Webster, if you'd stand. You can sit down once you stand up.
No, I'm not going to raise my hand.
Okay, you want to speak? Okay, yes, on something else. All right. Margaret Shockley?
I'm going to raise my hand.
Okay. Joseph Hill.
I've spoken my time too, Mr. Bank.
John Gerald.
I donate to Mr. Harris.
Dan.
Right here.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Harris can have my time.
Okay.
But I don't know if I'm going to leave.
Okay. Barbara Cook. You can stand, living up.
Donate my time to Mr. Harrington also.
Ron, Janet.
My time to Mr. Harrington.
All right. So at this time, we've got technically four speakers. And looking at the order of which they signed, Mr. Harrington will be first, and he will have a total of 15 minutes.
Gentlemen, my name is Thomas Harrington. I live at 650 Washington Street, Eden. I'm here representing, look around you, representing your bosses. And I'd say that I believe your bosses are proud of three of you already. You know, I brag a little bit. When have you seen anything like this? Since the time some of your predecessors tried to do us in with that tax valuation. No group, nobody, I think, in this county could turn out a group like this. Nobody. And I'm proud of them, and the county ought to be proud of them. These people do great work for the county, and they care. You know, I think I've sort of got a hunch as to how the resolution might pass that you all have just left on your agenda. So I want to talk to you for a few minutes, and I didn't need all that time because all this stuff, I've told it so many times, I feel a little embarrassed about telling you again. But I want to talk about the Witt Farm. I tell you, that's got to go. It could have and should have been stopped a long time ago. It is absolutely, the whole project is bad for this county. Can you imagine two big landfills in one county? When you think, you remember Mr. Farver, the lawyer from Reedsville, who came over here and told you what was happening in his home county of Lee in South Carolina, where one of these big outfits went in. The pile of trash they're working on now, he told us, was 17 stories high. And they're still piling on it. They ain't going up as far as they're going to go. They're still piling on that one. I don't believe that's what we want. It presents certainly a danger to the water. They're proposing this practically in the river. They all leak. It's a danger to our airport, which doesn't seem to bother them because they filed a lawsuit against the Board of Transportation in Raleigh to make them change their mind about whether or not it'd be dangerous for airplane traffic. It's 17 stories high. That pile of trash will be there 100 years from now. And what harm it will have done in that time, nobody can tell you because nobody's had a 100-year landfill that I know of. And these folks who come in and tell you, oh, but it ain't going to leak. No, they don't leak. Well, they don't leak much as they used to. Not going to bother water, not going to bother Eden, not going to bother Miller Brewing Company. If you don't think that they'll shove over here first time the newspapers come up and say about 100 gallons spilled out of the landfill last night and came down the creek, they will. They have to. What's he going to do to our reputation? What do we call ourselves there? The North Carolina's North Star. We'd be the North Dump. That's what we'll be. And don't think, by George, that and what we'll be called. We'll be the North Dump. So I think that it'd be so damaging. And as far as attracting new industry, what we're going to do? Go up to some fella who wants to think about moving his business and say, come on, move it down to us. Rockingham County, we got two huge landfill dumps. It's just not going to work. I think we'd be a laughing stock. The question is certainly, what has been the cost and why hasn't it been stopped? And let me tell you, I've been pretty free with my advice. But I'll tell you some advice I would have given you. When I found out that the application is not even legally signed by the LLCs, I believe I'd have said, folks, we better hold this thing up a while. It ain't even signed, and I'll go into that in more detail with you because I've had that studied. And then suppose I then found out that the partnership has an option on the land and are not even a party to the proceeding. And I was told, well, that doesn't matter. We don't ever do that. Well, I said, well, you ain't ever been right. I think I'd have told you, look, we can't have this. If this law is constitutional, if they can shut you up, y'all have apparently been advised that you better not open your mouths about anything. Your bosses must have wondered whether or not there was something wrong with you. All this was going on, you didn't seem to even know it because you were told you couldn't say a word about it. I don't believe that. Look at the Supreme Court of the United States. While the lawyers are arguing the case, they interrupted them and say, Ben, you know you don't believe that. They're right in the middle of it. And y'all haven't even asked these folks who owns it. And I bet you it's because, I would advise you, yes, you can tell them. You can ask them these questions. Also, when, from the beginning I did this, but when that letter came back from the DARPA expert they looked into down at the Institute of Government, talking about a franchise. And the last sentence in his letter says, there is no law on this. You can require it at the beginning or at the end of this permitting project. Well, you know good and well that you're probably not inclined. Well, look at them. Ask them if they want to give somebody a franchise to come in here and dump all the trash. No. And they, after all, they are the ones who own the county. So that if it held that and rejected the franchise application, I would advise you that I believe that would hold up and that'd be the end of it. And they'd have to go home. Another thing I would have told, I never would have told, I guess the sheep operated on the basis of advice from your legal department. I never would have told the planning people that the application was complete enough to go forward. How can it be complete enough to go forward when it ain't even signed? And look at, think about it. You got to, as I say, I'm going to go into that, but it puts you in a position of whether or not you're going to grant a permit for an, on an application that's not even signed by the applicant. No, no, no. And then another thing I'd have told you. I'd have said, look, there ain't nobody, including me in Rockingham County, who's got any expertise in this landfill thing. You got two big law firms working on you. One of them's got about 70 or 80 lawyers in it. The other's got over 100, two of the biggest firms in the state, with all kinds of paralegals and all that sort of stuff working on stuff. And I'd have told you, look, you better, I can't tote this. You better get somebody, because I'm gonna cause you trouble. And then I'd have given you some daredevil advice. I'd have said, look here, the planning department worked for y'all. They've come up with a decision that you can go forward. It's complete enough, I think. And I don't know. Now, I haven't checked this out, but I'd give it a whirl. I'd just send word down there, listen, we're stopping this thing right now. If you think we're going to spend this much time and money messing with something that hadn't even been signed, you're nuts. We're not going to do it. Just forget it. So anyway, that's the kind of advice that I would have given you. Now, I took, if I could give y'all some of it all during this thing, nobody paid much attention to me. But there's an outfit up in Charlottesville, Virginia, Florida Legal Research Incorporated. I've used them before. They do research for lawyers. And so I sent them this problem up there and asked them, how about researching it? It cost us $750. I believe the county could afford that, but it cost us. And I've got the report from up there dated June 13th from a senior attorney. And by the way, on this brochure they have endorsements by Duke professors, and that's for the work they do. I mean, they know what they're doing. And they say that, they tell me that this signature is no good. And I read you the last paragraph of it, and because I furnish any of the copies who want it. It says, possibly out of a lack of understanding of the legal requirements, the attempted executions on behalf of PBK and Huquit thus constituted no execution at all. Obviously, there was not even an attempt to sign the names of the two LLCs. Additionally, there's nothing to indicate that either of the individuals who signed their names to the application intended to sign as a manager, which presumably both either did know or should have known was necessary. Since there's nothing to indicate that either of them intended to sign as a manager of the LLC, it follows that neither LLC has signed the permit application, and so the application form before the department does not contain an application by either LLC and should not have been accepted any more than an application in the name of Sam Johnson should have been accepted if signed only by Peter Smith. Since these gentlemen signed the application in their names as individuals, not in the capacity of a manager, it seems that the only possible course for the LLCs would be to file a new and properly executed application. Gentlemen, this application never should have been accepted for filing. It came in and it was too important to mess around with. Came in and was set, was accepted. Who looked at it and decided that the signatures were proper? I don't know. But they accepted it and set it for a hearing 30 days later. If we hadn't stopped it, I'm going to stop it just 30 seconds. They set a hearing for it for 30 days later. Now, anybody knows, if they even, if the person handling it even knew what a landfill was. She had to know that there was no way to go through what you had to go through to have a hearing in 30 days. And they set another hearing before you all 30 days after that. And that's the thing has been a mess. And I tell you this, your bosses are sick and tired of it. Everybody, the county is sick and tired of it. And the county appreciates the steps that you all are taking. This thing should have been put to bed a long time ago. It got out of hand, got loose. And y'all been told you couldn't open your mouths and couldn't say anything. And if the Constitution allows you to do that, I'd have filed an action questioning the constitutionality of the thing. It would have taken 40 years probably for that to get through the court. But this thing has just been a mess. It hadn't been handled right. It was ill-advised to start with. It's too bad the folks, I don't know how much they really had, really truthfully have expended, but they shouldn't have tried to attack poor little Rockingham County in the first place. You can't just roll in and say, boys, like it or not, I'm gonna have me a pile of trash 17 stories high here before you know it. That's not gonna work. And therefore my recommendation, I'll give you some more of that advice. My advice is to get this thing on the docket and just say, look, I don't care what you've done, we're not going forward because we don't even have a properly executed, nothing's been done right, and we're not going forward and waste our time. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Tommy. And if you could we get copies of that report you got back from?
Yeah.
I know it'd be some interesting reading. At this time, it's 7 o'clock, and by our rules, we need to have our public hearing at 7 o'clock. And get the, she's already gone. And what we'll do is we'll come back and finish up with the other three speakers just as soon as we get through with this public hearing that was advertised at 7 o'clock. And that's what we need to proceed with. He's going to give us a copy of it.
Yeah, I'm in. See you right now.
Yeah.
You want to get it, Lance?
I'd like to see that. Thank you, Tom. We put one in Tommy's mailbox.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. All right, at this time we're down to item 8, and we will get back up to 6 for the other three speakers.
Make it quick.
And this time, Frankie, I got some rezoning requests.
This is case 2012-012, is a request for rezoning from residential protected to residential mixed. The applicant is Jack Jones for Stone Eden Baptist Church. The property is located on Priddy Loop near where Settle Bridge Road intersects with Priddy Loop. It's approximately, the lot would be approximately 2,800 square feet. That's the minimum lot size for what they would like to do. This is a straight rezoning and therefore no conditions may be imposed. Staff notes there are 34 allowed uses in residential in the residential mixed zoning district, and of those 34 uses, 19 are allowed by right, 9 with design standards, and 8 require approval of a special use permit. The planning board voted unanimously 10-0 to recommend approval of this case at its June 18th 2012 meeting. Planning staff also recommends approval.
Would the public want to see it too?
Is it the, you want this one?
gone.
Let's check, see if there's any commissioners. Commissioner Bass?
No questions, sir.
Commissioner Callum?
Frankie, did you have any people, anyone call in to complain or anything filed against this? Did you receive any complaints from anybody?
We received two calls of inquiry on it, but no one showed up at the planning board meeting. They were just calling to inquire what was going on, you know.
I know this is 28,000 square foot lot, and it does have a water source, and the only thing it has to provide, as far as the county's concerned, is the setback requirements as well as the compatibility for sewer. Is that correct?
Yeah. With what they would like to do on the property, they cannot do in the residential protected zoning district, and that is they want to put three attached residential units to be utilized for people, maybe elderly people or people who've had been a fire in their house and they have to have a temporary place to stay. So it'll be three dwelling units, but they cannot put those in a residential protected zoning district. So that's why the rezoning was required.
Okay. But it does meet the requirements with the setbacks and everything.
Yes, they can meet
it
the setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
And they've already had the environmental health work done also.
Okay. Does it leave a repairable field, or do they have a repairable field in areas for repairs?
We don't see any problems with it at all.
Okay. All right, then. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Commissioner Travis?
I have no questions.
Okay. Frankie, the only thing I would assume that the septic systems and all have been approved by...
Yes, it has, and the well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and the well.
The only thing that's going to have to happen is they will cut off the lot after that, after the rezoning is approved, because the residential units will be need to be on a lot separate from the church property.
There'll be two different parcels then?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right now, we only had one person to sign up for... this, and I've asked him if he would like to speak, to come forward, and you can stand beside Frankie if you like. Jack Jones.
Yes. It's Jack Jones. I'm a resident of Rockingham, lifetime resident of Rockingham County. Born and raised in Eden, I reside in Mayodan. I'm a member of Stone Eden Baptist Church. Also, I'm a licensed insurance agent with Physicians Mutual. Our pastor at our church had a vision to provide homes for widows, widows indeed. These are ladies, you know, biblically speaking, that have no family, no close of kin. And so ideally, that's what the idea behind these residences is for. The church was blessed by an inheritance. Some of you folks may remember Harold Schoaf, and Mr. Schoaf left his entire estate to the church. And one of the requirements was his name be upon a building. And our pastor felt this was an opportune time. The Lord had provided this money and to fulfill this lifelong vision that he has. And so we hope to fill these apartments up. And these ladies will be right in our church and to be continued to be ministered to. That's all I have.
All right, let me just scan the commission, see if they got any questions for you. Commissioner Bass?
No questions.
Mr. Callum?
Yes, sir. I want to commend you for what you're doing. You're putting a place and fixing something out there for people who are coming out of desperate straits. And to me, that's commendable. You're doing something that's good for the people, good for the, and you're helping out people who are in bad shape and down and out on their luck or who have lost everything. And with that, I think everybody ought to do what you're doing. And because everyone needs a helping hand at one time or another. And I'm sure that you can segregate these in a fashion to where everyone will have like a little separate places with some type of privacy. That's to their point. I'm sure you can do that.
These are self-contained little apartments for these with us primarily. That's what the use for it would be.
Well, Mr. Jones, I commend you 100% from this county for what you're doing. And it shows a great deal of heart in what you're doing, sir.
And it's been a lot of hard work.
I guarantee you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Commissioner Travis?
I have no question.
No, again, Mr. Jones, I appreciate what you're doing and what Eden Stone has done for the community.
Stone Eden.
Stone Eden. Yeah, Eden Stone. Stone Eden. It's Stone Eden is what it is. With no other further questions for Mr. Jones or Ms. Legault, I'll entertain a motion
for
approval.
If it's proper at this time, I'd like to make a motion for approval. The rezoning case 2012-010 for the rezoning of the Stone Eden Baptist Church.
I second.
Okay, I have a motion for approval. I have a second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Thank you.
Thank
Congratulations.
You.
Mr. Goode, you got another one here.
Won the lottery.
Mr. Chairman, would the board like to adopt the statement, the analysis and statement by separate vote? I think that might be the clearest thing.
Yeah. We're on number two, right?
Yeah.
No, we're still at number one. We need to approve the statements and analysis.
Yes, you have a form there. Of course, the general statutes require that the board, when it makes a zoning amendment, adopt an analysis and statement, and you have one there in your package.
Do you want me to reformat that motion, sir?
No, you can just do it by second vote. That makes
we
it clear.
Yeah, make a motion, entertain a motion for approval of the statements and announce.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the motion for the Stone Eden Church, the board to approve the residential mix or zoning amendments to adopt the following statements as required by the North Carolina General Statutes 153-8341 and under the statements of approval.
I second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second for approval of the statements. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Thank you. Thank you, County Attorney, for catching that. Go ahead, Frank.
This is case 2012-011. Is a request for rezoning from residential agricultural to highway commercial conditional district for compartmentalized storage with an outdoor storage yard for boats and IVs. The applicant is Steve Bruton. The property is located at 2341, and you can refer to this map. This is the property right here in purple. It's approximately 1.17 acres. This would be a reuse of an existing building that's there. Also, there has been some damage to that building, so that would clear up the damage to the building also. Planning Board voted unanimously 10-0 to recommend approval of this case with the attached conditions listed in your packet. At its June 18th, 2012 meeting, planning staff also recommends approval.
Okay, let me see if there's some questions. Commissioner Travis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Frank, I got a concern with highway commercial. Is this the only route that this person can go? We can't give them some kind of permit all he's doing is storing RVs, but if you look at the map, no one around there is highway commercial other than him.
That is correct, and that is the reason why it's a conditional district, because this would not allow any other use that's in highway commercial to go in. It only allows the use for the storage yard, and outdoor storage is only allowed in highway commercial. But he will have to have fencing, and he will have to have landscaping to screen from view those stored materials.
Okay, thank you, Frank.
Okay, Commissioner Bass?
No questions.
Commissioner Callum?
Sir, Frankie, how close does the opposing line come to the property owner on the other side of that house?
We did have.
Is it going to meet the requirements on setbacks?
Yes, he can definitely meet the requirements for setback.
Because it looked real close to me when I looked at it.
Yeah, he will meet those, you know, so.
Did you receive any complaints from any of the neighbors about the business that he conducts there, whether it be previously or recently or whatever?
We had two calls of inquiry, and then we had a gentleman who owns this property. And he was concerned that, about the loss of desirability for his property to perhaps in the future have a residential subdivision. And that was his basic concern. But it was, he doesn't really have any plans at the present time to do that. As you can see, I can show you the site plan.
Yeah.
I'll put that up. And
this is Ellisboro Road and along here. These are the parking spaces that are required for the building, for the compartmentalized storage. And this would be the driveway in to the parking area. This part of the property kind of drops off because down on another piece of property there's a stream. His property is over, Mr. Bruce's property would be on this side. I can turn it this way, but he and I can see the whole, see if I can get it down a bit. Okay, this is Ellisboro Road. This is the Chelsea Lane property that you're looking at, that the gentleman owns. But as you can see, he's going to have a buffer around here, and he will not have too many, he doesn't have room enough to store very many RVs
or boats in there. I think it was,
he's only showing 14
spaces for actually storage of RVs or boats, and one of the conditions that is that he cannot double stack them. So they'd just be individually parked there, so it would be basically spaces for 14. Either jet skis, boats, whatever, RVs, whatever they are, for a total of 14, you know, vehicles.
Frankie, recently when this was brought before, I understood his capacity there and what the limits would be. I didn't feel like it would be an imposition to the traffic and the people in that area. Is this here, has anything been done? Has the DOT, anyone made any kind of decision or problem with this addition coming
well,
out?
Well, as small as this is, we don't feel that there will be that much impact, that it will be a key entry system, so there will not be somebody there all the time. The people that have it would have a key to get into it. You may recall we had Dan Loftus that was further down the road that did the same thing. And that was all storage, and he had a larger facility. And then a little bit further down there, just past Wren Road, there is another facility that probably stores up to about 30 boats or RVs, but also does repairs. His will not have the repair service. It will just simply be the storage in that facility. So we think it'll be limited. Limited traffic in and out of there. I mean, obviously somebody's not going to be going in every day, in and out. The other thing that I'd like to note too is,
if you look at this, there is community shopping right here, right across the street, and there is a light industrial property just a few hundred yards up the road. So
we are seeing that Ellisboro corridor, we are seeing some commercial enterprises basically related to the Blues Lake that's there, and that's, you know, what a lot of these places are. They're either, you know, repair places for boats or storage places for boats. So we are seeing some of those come in, which is logical.
Okay. It's you don't anticipate any kind of impact then to the neighborhood or to the people using this corridor or this road, because at certain times on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, the Ellisboro Road is a very busy highway.
Yeah, well, obviously his driveway is going to have to be approved by NCDOT, and I believe that's already been done.
And one other thing is the lights on the property. Is the lights on his property going to be in a sufficient manner to where they don't impose on the surrounding neighbors?
Well, if he puts lights on the property, they'll have to be aimed and directed on the property so that they won't spill over to other pieces of property. And I would imagine with the cost of electricity, it'll be only those that are needed for security, what would be the minimal security. Actually, this type of facility would generate less traffic than one single-family dwelling. The Institute of Traffic Engineers estimates that one single-family dwelling generates 10 trips per day. So a facility like this would probably not see 10 trips per day of somebody going in and out. So it really would be less traffic than if probably a single-family dwelling was put there.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bell. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions, comments?
Want a motion?
Okay. If not, I'll entertain a motion for approval of case 2012-011. And the as well as the analysis and statements that is within this request.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for approval of 2012-011 and the statements associated with this.
The analysis and statements.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, I have a motion for approval. Do I have a second?
Second, Mr. Chairman.
I have a second by Commissioner Bass. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise? Okay, so carried. Okay, you got a couple of text amendments.
Yes. As we talked about last year, I think it was last year, when we put in the requirements for municipal solid waste landfill, there are other types of landfill, and we told you at that time we would be coming back with the requirements for other types of landfills. So we will now have a spectrum of approval. Beneficial fill is when you're going to fill a lot. That's allowed by right. There are some state requirements for it. They have to follow state requirements. Then we would have development standards for land clearing and inert debris, it's sometimes called LCID or C&D landfills. And a minor would be anything up to 2 acres, and that would be by development standards. The major would require a special use permit.
All right, let me check and see if there's any questions. Commissioner Bass?
No questions.
Commissioner Kellum?
No questions this time. Thank you, Brian.
Commissioner Travis?
No question.
I see that there was an 8-2 vote on this by the Planning and Zoning Board?
Yes. We did recommend. Yes, it was an 8-2 vote. There was concern. It was actually tabled one month to the following month for us to find out about asphalt, because used asphalt is allowed in LCID landfills. We did query Hugh Jennigan from Diener. It is allowed by the state. They also referred us to a study that was done by the University of Florida for solid and hazardous waste management. Basically, asphalt is a petroleum product, but it does not contain oil. And the process of making asphalt with the sand and the rock binds it together. So their concern was oil leaching, but even though it is a petroleum product, it does not contain oil, and that's basically what this study says went into. We had another couple of documents too, but I think most people were satisfied, but then some of them felt that we should not allow used asphalt.
Commissioner Kellum's got a question.
Franklin, let me ask you something. In closing out these types of landfills, in the procedure for doing that that's been adopted and set up, do they have to meet any kind of requirements or set monies back in an escrow account or something to that effect to be able to close these types of landfills out?
There are no federal requirements. There are state requirements. And one of those requirements is that when you establish one of these, that you have to have a surveyor come out, survey the property, and you have to register it with the Register of Deeds so that any future purchaser of a property that has had one of these LCID landfills on them will know that it has had a landfill, and they will know the parameters of that landfill. Asphalt is allowed in it, you know, there's nothing, you know, the state allows it, so, you know, if it were toxic, I think the state, it would be controlled, first of all, it'd be controlled probably by the federal laws to municipal solid waste landfills, but they are not. They're only state regulations, and the state says that asphalt can go in LCID landfills, so.
All right, is there any other questions, discussion? Now, with the text amendments, is there any special other than text amendments and definitions?
Yes, there's also an approval statement that goes with analysis and statement goes with a text amendment also. You have that in your package.
The statements. Okay. With no other discussion, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the text amendment and the statements that is in this UDO change.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would move for approval in accordance with the statement as outlined in our package.
Okay, I have a motion for approval. We got a second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. And also, it got slipped under some papers. Steve Bruton signed up to speak on behalf of what we've already passed on the Ellisboro Road. If you'd like to speak, you got a chance to come up and speak. If you've already passed.
No, thank you, sir. She said everything I would.
Okay, thank you a lot. I just didn't want to think I forgot you. It just slipped up under my papers. Okay, Frank.
All right. The last item that we have is a text amendment regarding turkey shoots. At the current time, turkey shoots are only allowed if they're associated with nonprofit organizations. We have had several people, and only for a 90-day period. So we would still like to continue that. We'd like to put in also there are people out in the county who have approached us who would like to do year-round turkey shoots on their property for profit. And so basically that's, if it's going to be for profit, we would recommend a special use permit, and those have been included in your text. So that's the big
one. Okay, let me check to see if there's a question. Commissioner Travis?
No, I don't have a question.
All right, Commissioner Callum?
Frankie, we're talking about operating a turkey shoot and doing this as a business on an organized level on a year-round basis and everything. What restrictions and everything is we place into this to where I could see a lot of it, but I don't see anything that says a timeline would be run from a certain amount of time to a certain amount of time. And I understand the backstops and all these things in the distance and the lines, they have to be maintained for safety, and it have to be fenced in. I read that. But to be able to operate this in an area of time to where it would be compatible with the surrounding neighbors, to where they wouldn't be out there at 10 o'clock at night shooting a turkey, shooting somebody trying to sleep.
Yeah, and that was one of the reasons. They're usually turkey shoots are an 8-shot, and I'm not that familiar with guns, so I'm just going by what I've been told. But what we did, we looked at other ordinances, what they're doing currently, but we also found a research that was done in 2008 regarding shell ballistics and penetration, and we used those distances that were considered safe distances by this report that people would not be injured seriously if they were at this distance from someone who is shooting. So that's what we based our standards on, was a 2008 shotgun shell ballistics and penetration report.
So we would be working then, from what I can read, is we'll be working with the county standard noise ordinance.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Who would enforce that?
Well, it could be. It depends on what it is. Okay. We would have Tinker go out and see if they were following the requirements of the ordinance. Obviously, they would have to. For one of them is a special use permit. So. The permit could be revoked if they were not following the ordinance, the special use permit. The other one is for, would continue as it is for the 90 days. They have to come in and get a special event permit if they are a nonprofit organization. So if we found that they were not following the requirements for that, then we would have the option, if it was to not issue it to them again until they could comply with that, so, with the requirements.
Do you have anything that you know of built into this that says that they would have to control or not have a fire or build fires like they, around every turkey shoot I went to, they had 5 or 6 barrels and all of them burning?
Well, there's always, there are always people who might want to do that, but if they're, you know, if it's a part of the turkey shoot or not, or are they just shooting, you know, I mean, that's what you have to decide, whether it's just a random thing or whether it's actually part of the turkey shoot.
Okay, thank you, Frank. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Commissioner Bass?
Yes, thank you. Mr. Legault, did this request come before the planning board?
This, yes, it did.
Okay, what was the count of approval or disapproval?
They voted 10-0 to recommend approval.
10-0.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. I have one. Just have brain cramp, I guess. You get over 50, you can do that legally. I think Commissioner Callum caught me off guard and asked my question, so I'll
you want a motion?
I'll entertain a motion for the approval of the text amendment and statements.
I'll make a motion for a text amendment and the statements associated with this.
Okay, I have a motion made. Do I have a second?
I second, sir.
I have a second made by Commissioner Callum. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Thank you, Frank. All right, this time we'll jump back to item 6, and which is public comment period. And Georgia Graves, please state your name and address, please.
Georgia Graves, 125 Ivy Road. Oh, I'm sorry, Chairperson, members of the board. Georgia Graves, 125 Ivy Road, Ruffin Township. It's been exactly 2 years since I've been here. And the complaint was about the vegetation around my house, two abandoned buildings, not livable, and just 3 sides. I can only see out the back of my house. In the front, I got this huge gully, and then vegetation's growing. Within 2 years, it's up there, you know. And it's continually growing. You have animals coming out, you know. I actually have to look when I come out of my house. So it's dangerous. What I'm wanting to know is there any kind of way to dissolve this near future? Is it feasible? I've waited 2 years. I mean, I just wanted to know.
Do you want to ask to Ms. Graves a question?
Yes, Ms. Graves. We just passed a ordinance for yes. This. I suggest you get with Tinker Woods and our county attorney. I think the rule states that if 5 complaints come in, then they will start doing something. So if you can get your neighbors, get them to come up here and complain and file a complaint on it, then we can take action on tearing them houses down and taking mm-hmm. care of it for you.
Okay, would this just be only me? I mean, I'm the one complaining about it around me.
Hey, you go down the road. Go down the road and get your neighbors.
You mean
complain.
People right,
right
in the area?
Yes, ma'am. And if you do it, I'm sure our county will, Tinker Woods will investigate it. And if it's good, because we just passed a bill to allow us to go ahead and tear, you know, tear.
Am I well aware of that? Because Tinker told me.
That's
we've
right.
been calling, and you said 5 people?
5 people. Am I correct, Eugene? 5 people?
That's is correct.
Yes. 5 people.
And you want me to refer them to Tinker? Come out here?
Yeah, Tinker. Refer all 5 of them to Tinker.
Ms. Graves,
I want to ask you a question.
Commissioner Collins got something for
you. Tell me, all these houses that you mentioned, everything, these properties, they're all vacant, I assume. Nobody's
vacant,
living there.
Yes.
And they're all near in and near your house in a neighborhood.
Right there, yes.
Are they on the same road that you're on?
Same road.
Okay. Do you think that these houses also, not only being grown up, and all the vegetation growing in around them, everything, constitute a threat in more ways than one, as far as from any kind of rats, rodents, health threat? Do you think they constitute any kind of health threat towards you?
My health. I am a heart patient, and I do wear ICD, and
Well, if they do constitute a health threat, then our county manager can help you utilize this thing through our environmental people. But that comes under environmental concerns here in the county, and also we can utilize that department to help this, in this situation, to help benefit this situation with you.
Okay.
It's more than one way.
Am I needing to have them see Tinker personally or by phone or come out here?
Call them. Call them.
Yeah, just give.
They don't have to come up here. I can just call.
Okay.
Mr. Travis.
All right, thank you. All right, at this time, go down to Ms. Scott, Mabel.
My name is Mabel Scott. I'm the Public Information Officer for Rockingham County Government. To our County Commissioners, Chairman May, County Manager Metzler, ladies and gentlemen, if you are 18 years of age and a Rockingham County citizen or business owner, this message I'm about to share is for you. Please apply for the Rockingham County's First Citizens Academy. This free 10-week session of classes will help you better understand how Rockingham County government actually operates. Every department head, the county manager, county commissioners will work together to help to take these participants and students and give them a behind-the-scenes look at county government. They will learn insightful, interesting information to enable them to experience civics in action. These exciting educational classes won't be boring, but will involve hands-on experiential learning, videos, simulations, role-playing, group interaction, tours, technology, problem-solving, case studies, dialogue, discussion, homework, and much, much more. Our inaugural fall classes are from 6 to 8 p.m. every Thursday, September 6th through 8th. Participants will graduate November 13th. Completed applications must be received by midnight Tuesday, July 31st. Those chosen will be expected to participate in the entire program. The Citizens Academy Steering Committee includes County Commissioner Harold Bass, Rockingham Community College President Michael Helmick, County Manager Lance Metzler, and yours truly. Please apply for the Citizens Academy and become a committed civic ambassador to enlighten others about Rockingham County government. You can apply online via the county's website, or you can pick up an application downstairs here at the Rockingham County Governmental Center in the lobby, or you can call me, Mabel Scott, 342-8342. You told me I could have some of your minutes. Mr. May. Okay. Apply for the Citizens Academy and learn everything you always wanted to know about Rockingham County government but didn't know who to ask. Please apply for the Citizens Academy. Participate in the American dream and our democratic process. Remember, we just celebrated July 4th with our red, white, and blue, so getting involved with your local government is now left up to you. Please apply for the Citizens Academy.
Thank you, Mabel.
Yes,
and you still had 25 seconds to go.
Please apply. We've done very well, but we need some more participation so we can make sure that there are representatives from every part of the county.
Thanks. That was a good advertisement.
Thank you, sir.
And lastly is Bobby Webster.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm just here on a concern for the children of Rockingham County. My name is Bobby Webster. I live at 149 JW Road in Madison. And my concern is the termination of children's services at Daymart. They discontinued psychiatric services and counseling services for the children of Rockingham County effective June 22nd of this year. That leaves the only psychiatric help for the children in the county located in Reidsville. There are a lot of people that need a lot of help that don't live in Reidsville, that live on the western side of the county, that live in Stoneville and Eden. And it is certainly going to be a hardship for those folks to seek services all the way in Reidsville. That leaves us with two agencies that have psychiatric services for children in this county. and it is going to be a great loss for the Children's Services at Daymark, which was centrally located in Wentworth. For the kids, I think it was approximately 200 children are going to be affected by those termination of services in the county. And that's including med evaluation, psychiatric care, and therapy, and counseling. And that is a service that is going to be sorely missed in the county, and I would just like the commissioners to be aware of that hardship on the kids that are here in this county.
All right, thank you a whole lot for letting us know that. Appreciate your concern. All right, at this time, that's all the speakers that we had signed up. So at this time, we go down to item 7. Commissioner Bass, you got any comments?
Yes, I do. Thank you. First of all, I want to thank Ms. Scott for the information she brought to us. And I want to thank all of those who have applied for our Citizens Academy. Each class will be a total of 25 people. And thus far, I believe we have 19 or 20. So the deadline is July 31st, midnight. I would encourage you to please do so. As you can see, if you're observant, there's a great need for better understanding of how our government works and how it can affect you. Also, it will teach you and tell you of how you may volunteer to help it. It's your government, and we would ask you to please take advantage of this opportunity to come out and get involved. Thank you, Mr. Manager. Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Commissioner Keller?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I realize that we all need an education in something at some form of time or another, and we all hold certain degrees and levels within that education. I feel like that the majority of everybody that I know that sits on this board has a good education in any form and any text that you look at. I think we've been educated and conformed, and I think we know our job. We don't need instruction from anything or anybody. We do need good advice, and we also need your help. When you have good advice in construction, you can come in and tell us, then we will listen. Then we'll sit down and render a good verdict that is intelligent, that does meet the requirements of this county and the people in it, and for the benefit of the people in it and what's being done. We're not going to meet any criteria that sets a personal goal for any one person, for any one benefit person. We're not going to do that. And I'm not going to support anything that does. Now, as far as Ms. Grace, I'm going to go back and go through these one at a time. Ms. Grace, the vegetation and problems that you got around your house, Rockingham County has a building ordinance built into our county today we have that will control that. We just got through setting this here ordinance up and writing it for the very benefit of controlling just these very problems. And all you need to do basically is go through the problems of the administration that we have here in our county, and I'm sure that you'll get that problem solved for you. Ms. Scott, I do commend you for that, for what your work and everything you've done. To educate the citizens in our county on the Citizens Academy is a good thing. It will give them an outstanding understanding of how county government works, to where you will understand and know that you won't be hoodooed when you listen to what is being done or said by any one single person or anybody else. So you will have a good education. The said thing, Ms. Bobby Webster, I'll tell you what, I understand your questions and your concerns with the children in our county and their mental health and their complete future and everything. I wasn't aware of the hardship and stuff that you now that you've mentioned that you brought forth that you're suffering with, but I will look into it to see exactly what's coming from it and what exactly what the impact is. And I hope that you would call me and talk to me personally and tell me exactly what you got going on and what is the impact. And I will look into it also. Mr. Harrington, your remarks and everything that you made and everything today has not only been enlightening, it's been very educational. I don't think there's nobody sitting here today that could not stand up and say that what you said today is an earth-moving situation. Also, it's very, you correctly have pointed out today there are misgivings and some ideas and some things, and other people too who suspect things that they assume to be correct. Went in with the professionalism that you have brought forth, as well as from the people that you have went out and solicited advice from and stuff, and spent your own monies and things to do this. I commend you for that, because you're not doing it for your own self. You're doing it for the people of this county. And with that said and done, I can't think of anybody that shouldn't receive the Citizens of the Year Award. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Commissioner Travis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. All the speakers, I'm pretty sure we kind of answered some of your questions. Ms. Webster, I'll get with staff and same as James and see what we can find out. It's my understanding is we are offering children's mental health in the county. I think Daymark was just another duplication of something that we already offered, but don't quote me on that. I will check and get with the county to make sure I'm correcting that. And hopefully the staff will get back with you with what we decided, okay? And as all the other speakers, of course, Tommy, thank you for your eloquent comedy speaking there. It's always good to hear from you. I just want to bring up a couple items. One, I want to give all the staff a praise. I don't know if the citizens of this county know this yet or not, but the staff has been real concerned about health insurance costs for the county, and they had a meeting with the health insurance provider yesterday or day before, and it went down almost 17%, so we're saving the county $1 million. So you have to give the staff praise on that. And on top of that, I've said it during the budget process, the staff also worked hard at cutting costs because they saved $5 million off your proposed budget. And you got to give Lance and his staff, Pat and everybody credit for that because, again, that's something that has never been done in this county, never. And that's huge. On another note, I'd like to bring to the attention of the public a significant cooperation effort that was made between some of your commissioners up here and our county manager and State Representative Burt Jones and Brian Holloway. Just a few months ago, before the start of the short session in the General Assembly, we met with Representative Jones and Holloway and asked for their help in making Rockingham County more cost-efficient in the way we handle construction costs, especially school construction. After seeing firsthand the excessive waste of money and construction time involved in the traditional separated bid processes, we asked for the representatives to introduce a local bill that would permit our county to use design-build delivery methods. This would allow the county, when we need to build, renovate, or any kind of structure or start some kind of construction project, that we can use a single bid process for the design and the construction of that project. Studies have shown that this method of cost saving could save up to 20% of the cost of the project. And folks, I don't know if you remember the courthouse, $55 million, think about 20% off that $55 million we could have done. So this is big. The Representative Jones and Holloway introduced a bill, 2012-140, House Bill 994, that permits Rockingham County to utilize this method for up to three projects over the next 5 years. This bill has the potential to save our county taxpayers tremendous sums of money while providing for the needs of the community. We owe a great deal of thanks to our representatives, Burt Jones and Representative Brian Holloway, for getting this important bill through that will help stretch our tax dollars a little further. We are working hard to keep our tax rate down in more ways than cutting funds, as some would have you believe otherwise. I'm sure y'all know what I'm talking about. On another note on economic development, our county continues to lag behind other counties of our size. At the state level, our unemployment rate remains around 11%, and that is only the decline, folks, because the people that were looking for jobs can't find a job, so they stopped looking. You got to understand that. Really, the unemployment rate's probably around 20%, if you want to get technical. People stopped looking for jobs, and then their benefits run out. So, it's been a major concern of me for the last 2.5 years on economic development. It's time for us to take control of our own destiny. We need to be proactive in the effort to bring business to Rockingham County, both large and small. For much too long, we have remained content to allow others to do what they believe is in our best interest. And I'm talking about the partnership. It is time for us to take control of this. For much too long, These people have invested their own time and their interests, not yours. Let's face it, folks, it ain't working. It's not working at all. We can no longer sit on our hands and wait for something to fall from the sky or sprinkle pixie dust, as one director told me, over a project or a problem that is not being fixed. We have to promote our county like never before. We have to think outside the box like never before. We have to stop sitting by a phone and waiting for that large business to pick up the phone and say, hey, we're interested to come to Rockingham County, because that's not going to happen. And I think Lance knows I have been saying this for, you know, a while. Every aspect of what we can offer has to be exposed, whether it is property and buildings or recreation aspects, traditional and non-traditional. I call on the county manager right now to take on as a priority to explore every possibility, every avenue to accelerate business activities in Rockingham County. You know, folks, I've been doing a lot of research on economic development, and I've been getting a lot of input. You know, it's pretty bad when I have my county manager going to Remington to find out if they're leaving when my economic development team can't even go there and ask. That's a big problem. And I want to bring this to attention because economic development needs to be changed. It's no longer about large businesses anymore. You know, we're a tier one county. We cannot wait for another Miller Brewing Company to come. You know, granted, I appreciate, and I'm sure most of the people here appreciate so much, you know, Gerbing, Remington, Miller, all the other businesses are here. But you got to understand, they make up 20% of the tax base. 20%. It's small businesses that make up over 80% of Rockingham County's tax base. So we got to stop looking at large businesses and start working on small and medium-sized businesses. You know, I've been saying this. This is the second meeting in a row that I've mentioned economic development, and I'm not going to let up on this until something gets changed. You know, I am stepping on a lot of toes. I am. And because the powers of be in this county don't want to change because they're making money from it. Understand that. They're making money off of your suffering. And that's what needs to be changed. And I'm tired of it. I'm asking this board to give Lance direction to go after this and create Rockingham County Economic Development, not North Carolina Economic Development. Thank you.
Ms. Graves, the only thing I can tell you is that we've got some avenues for that, as you've heard, and that's certainly some ways we can get that taken care of. As far as the Daymark situation goes, does that fall under Larry? Or okay, and if you would, if Lance can get you your email, he will email you the results of what he finds. Would that be okay?
That's fine.
That way you'd have a document of exactly what transpired. As far as what Mr. Harrington said about the landfill and whether or not the signatures are, or the signature, whether it's plural or not, I hadn't the document. But whether it's legal or not, the judge certainly didn't take it on and make a real big decision about it. So whether planning and zoning errored, that's something for this board to decide how to handle, I would think. You know, if somebody made a mistake, then the board should be able to remedy that or come up with a remedy for that. As we continue and getting on down the line, got Ann Griffin, the executive director of Western Rockingham Chamber of Commerce, here.
Good Gentlemen, thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I really appreciate this time, and I am delighted to be able to be here as a messenger of terrific news about economic development in Western Rockingham. For the first time ever, both Mayadan and Madison applied for the NC STEP grant. It is only available to populations less than 7,000 people. And so for the first time, the two towns applied, and everybody was shocked when they made the first cut. They select 10 towns every other year to be included in the STEP program, and they're included because the towns are decimated by manufacturing going away, by loss of jobs, and also by natural catastrophes, as Bertie County was a year or so ago when the tornadoes came through. The Rural Center gives us a job coach. It's all about economic development. It's all about redeveloping the area to create an atmosphere for job creation. What they do is come in, and for the next 18 months, Madison and Mayadan will be meeting once a month to create a strategic plan for the next 5, 10, and 15 years for how the town will look. Now, the better news that I have for you is I'm not here to ask for money, which everybody loves, because the Rural Center, the towns will split $25,000 for the strategic planning part of it, and then each town will receive $50,000 to implement the plan, and also uses seed money for leveraging to get additional funds from grants, loans, and any other funds that may be available. We are, as you can imagine, so excited about this because we know that there have been times other towns have applied 4 or 5 times before they have ever been admitted to the program. And this was the first time out, and both have been admitted. We're going to ask for your help with this. We know that we have your goodwill, because every time I see any of you, you always say, let us know what you need, how we can help you. We're going to need your support, and by support, your presence, because we're going to be able to do several things. Next Thursday night on the 19th will be our very first strategic planning meeting at 5:30 at the Mayadan Fire Department. That'll be the step off. But we're going to do 2 major celebrations. One on September the 8th as part of the Mayadan Festival. The other on Saturday, September the 15th. Madison will do theirs. We would love to have all of you here for that and be a part of that. And we hope that you'll be, as county commissioners, our best cheerleaders throughout the county, because this is going to make a major difference in how Madison and Mayadan redo their futures and the economic development of jobs. And we'll include everybody in the county, because they'll be wanting to come put jobs in the West as well. So we appreciate your attention to this, your continued support, and we'll look forward to working together to form that great partnership, because what's good for us is good for the whole county. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you a whole lot, Ms. Griffin. If you'd stand by, I would think there's going to be some questions for you. And I'm going to start out with Commissioner Bass.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Griffin, I don't have any questions. I just want to congratulate you. And I would ask that you would make sure Ms. McLain have those dates so that she can help us schedule ourselves to be there.
We will do that, and we will also, you will all be receiving written invitations for that, but just wanting to put it on a save your date while you're taking notes tonight.
Good. And again, thank you and congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Commissioner Travis.
Thank you. Ann, I've worked with you before, and I appreciate everything you and your chamber does, especially for small business. And I know for a fact that based on direction from the board, we've had Lance up there on several occasions here recently to go look at your businesses. I think Lance is wanting to have a goal here of meeting every business in Rockingham County. So I'm glad he's starting off on the western side, because I know for a long time y'all have always felt like y'all was a redheaded stepchild up there. But but trust me, you're not. My family has business up there. And if anybody's ever been to Madison, the way y'all worked on downtown with the little shops, you know, Ann, I've been preaching for years now about citizens need to get out and just walk around, and you'd be surprised what gold mine you might find, because there's some nice little shops up there, and I appreciate everything you do, and I hope I can attend, you know, some of your events.
We hope so, too, and we may be the redheaded stepchild, but I think this has energized both the two towns to the point where even if we are, we're going to be a loud redheaded stepchild. And Mr. Travers, I can tell you, as the chamber director in the West now, I know both Eden and Reedsville have their own economic development people, so that naturally falls to me as the chamber director, but I usually get 3 or 4 calls a month from people saying, I want to move my business to Rockingham County. What do I need to do? So there are people who want to be here, and we want them here.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, with the way, you know, you heard my spiel about economic development, but a lot of people don't understand the way the partnership's set up right now. They just go after large businesses, and we've had several businesses that were turned away because our partnership couldn't deal with them. You know, I mean, I know this. I've got letters from these companies that said this is what happened. So I appreciate what you do, and I hope you continue to work with Lance, and, you know, I hope here in the next 6 months that we can change everything around.
Commissioner Callum?
Ms. Griffin, I applaud you for what you're doing. You're helping bring the community together to where we can do through initiative, bring our young people into this, create more jobs opportunities, and to be able to bring the whole community together for the betterment of this county. What you're doing is a Walmart on it. I'm not sure about the cheerleading that you expect and what you need. I'm not able to jump and clap and kind of round and cut flips like my granddaughter does, but I'll be glad to stand with you and work with you in any way whatsoever.
Correct.
To where we can make this initiative work. And I do applaud you for doing that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and Ms. Griffin, it is just kudos of congratulations. And the NC STEP program, you know, is very limited. You know, as you know, when you made the first cut, you cheer, and then when you actually get it, you know, then you celebrate.
Right.
And certainly, as it mentioned earlier, in order for us to get any jobs, the 2, 4, 6, 20, 30s, we have to do things like NC STEP and do things that are not what was done 8, 10, 12 years ago, because the economic situation of 8, 10, 12 years ago has changed, and what worked then does not work now. And if you don't think differently, you're going to be sitting here and ain't nobody going to be here.
But one other initiative that the chamber will be solidly behind and partnering with the Rockingham County Schools is another rural center project called the New Generation Initiative, which means that they will do, it's basically a STEP program for kids who aren't sure if they want to go to college, but maybe I want to be a business owner at 17. They provide the same strategic planning. They provide helping them find funding, so they could be a business owner by the time they graduate. And we are going to be solidly behind that and seeing how we can partner with the civic clubs and the schools to make that happen.
Well, again, thank you for all you and your chamber does. And if any way we can help you, you let us know. Well, and again, thanks.
Thanks
a
lot.
This time, we'll go down to Lance Metzler's county manager, and we've got some items there we need to address.
Okay, Mr. Chair, Board of Commissioners, in your packet, you've got a resolution laid out, as a lot of discussion has been made tonight, about decline the privatization of the Rockingham County landfill located on Schoaf Road. The county has, in the past, since PBK had approached the county, we have had several private solid waste companies provide us with requests to be considered if the county decided to privatize our landfill and its operations. Several commissioners had requested a legal to develop a resolution to decline the privatization of operations for the Rockingham County landfill. The rationale was made to make sure that the county could stay in control of its own destination and preserve the future of where the landfill is going to go and for future generations. It was also conveyed that the resolution would convey the message to the private sector, the county is not open for the landfill business right now, so if you would like to, Mr. Chair, if I can find the resolution, I will read that aloud.
I got it right here, if you'd like for me to read.
Okay, I got it, 374.
Page 74.
You want me to read it?
Sure, I can get it.
Okay. All right, I'll read the resolution. Well, first off, we'll go through some, ask if there's any discussion or questions. Commissioner Travis?
You know, it's been a big decision on this, because a lot of different companies have shown interest of our landfill. You know, it's a big decision to make, but, you know, ultimately, you know, the decision is your decision. You're the taxpayers, you're the citizens, and I've heard, you know, overwhelmingly, you know, the citizens' concerns on this, and that's why I was, well, one of them that requested that this be done, because I'm not for selling off our landfill. I'm not for partnering with anybody on our landfill. I feel like as long as the board and the citizens have control of our landfill, it won't be 4,000 tons a day or 5,000 tons a day. It'll be what we decide to put there. And my thoughts are, if our landfill is so valuable, then it's like Keith says, you know, why can't we do it ourselves? We can do it ourselves. I can go to Greensboro right now and say, hey, we're willing to work with you. How much you willing to get pay us? And instead of someone else making money, we can make the money. And that's one reason why I brought this up. It's nothing against any of the businesses that applied or gave us proposals. I appreciate the proposals. But again, if you remember correctly, we didn't ask for any proposals. They came to us. We didn't ask. So, you know, that's just my thoughts. Thank you.
Okay, Commissioner Bass?
Thank you. My position is I'm not opposed to the resolution here. As an elected official, I think we have a duty and responsibility to hear all of the concerns for and against, up and down, and particularly, regardless of where the money came from, if we're spending $90,000 for a study, somebody needs to hear that and look at it and see what options we may have. It just makes good sense to me. We can also, it could be a public hearing, our citizens could come in, they could also ask questions. I don't see the necessity of rushing into this, but I would also want you to understand that I'm not opposed to the resolution. I just want to hear all the options. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner Bass. Commissioner Keller?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I traveled and I went around this county in all areas and places, and I looked at most of it and talked to a lot of people in our county. I found very few people that did not come out and tell me that this county, this landfill belongs to the people in our county. It's part of this county. It's the future of our county. It is also part of the thing that our heritage that we're going to be leaving our children. And it's not to interfere with it, cut it down, subsidize it, or sell it. I had absolutely nobody out there come to me in a long, long time that said and told me anything differently or likewise. We are a byproduct of the people of this county. You were voted, and you voted us into office. You hired us to work for you. And by all judgments and standards, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to work for the people in our county and exactly what they want to do. I don't think there's a commissioner on this board that doesn't sympathize or go with that process. This resolution here is designated by the people of this county for the people of this county to send a message to everyone in this county to let them know exactly and precisely where this board sits and where we're at today. I don't think we need anything. Now, the GBB and their accounting that they're doing now is going to give us insight into how we can use our own landfill, how we can make money from that landfill and bring it back into here so it'll profit the people in this county. That study right there will give us that insight and that ability. It's not a waste of time and money. and I believe it now is the time that we need to do this, to set the standards straight and to put this forward to everybody and to set the concerns straight so that every citizen in this county will know exactly where we're coming from and where we're going. And that's about as plain as I can put it, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Yeah, you put it straight. As far as my comments, I gave them to you earlier on how valuable that property is to us and to the future of Rockingham County. Certainly the $90,000, $89,000, whatever it is, that's coming out of the landfill money is money well spent, and that report needs to be well reviewed, and it'll be for our future generations. However, what you have in front of you, what you have now could change at the next election. So it's something for the people of Rockingham County to consider. At this time, I'll read this resolution, so it'll be part of the record, and it'll be for the media as well. It's a resolution declining privatization of the Rockingham County landfill located on Shuff Road. Whereas Rockingham County for a number of years has maintained and operated a county landfill facility on Shuff Road, south of NC 704 between the towns of Wentworth and Madison, and whereas such facility has been operated to provide Rockingham County citizens access to solid waste containment and disposal within applicable state regulations and environmental requirements, and to promote and encourage safe and healthy solid waste disposal practices, and whereas the county has carefully managed its landfill operations with a view to preserving the Shuff Road facility to meet the needs of Rockingham County, its municipalities, and its citizens for years into the future, and whereas a well-maintained, accessible landfill operation with sufficient capacity is a valuable asset for the economic growth and the residential viability of a community, and whereas Rockingham County Board of Commissioners and staff have been approached by a number of waste management entities interested in the privatization and expansion of the Rockingham County's current landfill, and whereas such proposed expanded landfill offers Rockingham County the potential for additional revenues for the county, but increases the risk that the current county landfill facility will be fully utilized and closed prematurely, causing Rockingham County and its citizens to undergo the difficult and expensive process of relocating and replacing the county's landfill operation. And whereas the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners has carefully considered what policy is best appropriate to serve the long-term interests of Rockingham County and its citizens, now therefore be it resolved by the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners that the current landfill facility be operated and maintained on a long-term basis for as many years as practical under the prudent management and meet the needs of Rockingham County and its citizens, and not expand or privatize, this date the 10th of July 2012.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for approval of this resolution.
Mr. Chairman, I second it.
I have a motion made by Commissioner Travis, seconded by Commissioner Callum. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise.
Abstain.
Okay, let there be a roll call vote. Commissioner Travis?
Four.
Commissioner Callum?
Aye.
Commissioner Bass?
Abstain.
Okay, and as chair, I'm voting for it. So it passes at 3-1.
Yay.
The next item on the agenda is goes back to the county manager, item B.
Yes, Mr. Chair, this is something that you all have apparently discussed before, but basically this is consolidation of county Medicaid transportation services within our Council of Aging or Aging Disability and Transient Services for Rockingham County. And I'll just shorten that as ADTS when I bring it back up. Right now, we contract with ADTS to do our in-county Medicaid transportation administration, follow-up scheduling, and so forth. We also have duplication of services with DSS doing out-of-county medication transportation and administrative services. And what we met with the Council on Aging, we met with DSS, myself, to discuss a more effective and efficient way to approach transportation, particularly for those who utilize our Medicaid transportation. And at the conclusion, we concluded that it would be best to have a one central location, one call center to field those calls and to administer the operations of Medicaid transportation for both in and out of county. So I would recommend that you all consider allowing the Council on Aging or the Aging Disability and Transient Services to administer all the sole administration responsibility for scheduling, billing, verifications, gas vouchers, and other managerial functions of the program for Medicaid transportation in and out of county. Now, DSS will still be involved with doing the monthly statements to get reimbursements from the state, but we would ask that the Council on Aging do the remainder of the responsibility for transportation within the county. It makes it, again, there's a redundancy of services. We're having a collaborative effort with another agency. It makes perfectly good sense. They call one place, and the one company, which is the Council on Aging, does all the responsibility, makes sure the scheduling is done. It reduces drastically issues with scheduling, issues with billing, issues with preparation. So with that being said, I would recommend that you all allow ADTS to be solely responsible for handling all in and out of county Medicaid transportation functions in collaboration with our Department of Social Services.
Okay, so in fact, and it only makes sense, true, real good sense, business sense, that to have one call center, because I have heard of issues of scheduling whoops and people not getting picked up or delivered on time to certain places. That's not good. Sort of like, who shot John? Who'd you call? Who did they call? Well, if you got one place to call and one group's responsible, then Mr. Covington and his group ought to be the one that gets a call. They should administer it. They should work it. They should do it. And let them dispatch it out or whatever's decided among that group. It's only makes business sense to me. Commissioner Travis, you got a comment?
Yeah, I got some questions. You know, I know it makes sense, and it saves in time and money and reduces costs, but, you know, what happened to the competition? You're providing a service, you got Pelham Transportation providing services, you got all these companies providing service, and that provides a competition for you. And I'm not for having just one provider. So my question is, if someone out in Pelham needs a pickup, do you call Pelham Transportation to go get them, and they share in this cost thing?
Let me answer that. They will still utilize the private contractors. It's not that they're going to have a sole source. They'll still use them. They'll just be able to dispatch it more effectively. Whereas now they're calling Pelham, they're calling Council on Aging, they're calling DSS. Instead, it's a one-stop shop, and they'll call Lee's office, and Lee will determine who it best goes out.
Right. I mean, that may make sense, you know, but I can see it. 2 years down the road, I'm going to start getting complaints that they don't get enough phone calls, and then we're going to go right back to what we was doing before. I do agree there should be one phone call number you call for a pickup. It saves in confusion. You see what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I can just add one more thing. We're going to have a much larger discussion on transportation and the issues that we have on transportation, not only with Medicaid transportation, but with all the private, public people who provide transportation here. But I did meet with Pelham, and they are concerned because they're overwhelmed. they have too many calls. They're wanting to push off on others to take some of these issues, so that this will help solve some of these issues.
I mean, I'm all for it, Lance. I'm all for it. I say let's vote for it, but I think that we need to have some guidelines in place that any kind of transportation needs reports, everything reports directly to Larry Johnson, because it's DSS. He'll handle all complaints that come through there, and he tries to make sure it's a fair division of transports. I mean, I want to be fair. I don't want to leave, you know, I'm very surprised I haven't got any phone calls from these other groups.
They're overwhelmed.
Yeah, so, I mean, so I'm all for it. I mean, as long as Larry feels like he can handle it. Yeah, Larry, ain't you ready to retire yet, Larry? Just taking on.
Don't say that.
I mean, I'm all for it, but you understand my concerns, yeah. And as long as the staff and Larry understands the concerns and they're willing to deal with it, and I'm all for this approval.
No doubt, I think between Larry and Lee, any complaints that come in, they should be able to handle those. Commissioner Bass, you got any comments, questions?
Yes. First of all, I want to thank our county manager for your research and work and effort you've done on this. I sincerely accept your recommendation, and you have my full support. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Callum?
I think it's a good idea to where we can consolidate these things for services and things, and similar to what our county manager just said, he said one-stop shopping. That will give the citizens in our county the independent opportunity to make one call and put it all together and make it work. And anytime you could simplify anything for anybody like that, you've won. And I think that is a great deal winner. The ADT people will be sending their billing through to the county, and the county will then pass that billing on to the state and that thing. And the only thing I can hope is that we don't overwhelm Larry, as our chairman has alluded, to where he doesn't pack up and leave our county.
I know.
We don't want to do that and throw rocks and give the man a hard time. But we will work to support you in any ways necessary. And I'm sure that I know our county manager will too, Larry. So thank you, sir, for your services. Thank you, Mr. Manager.
Okay. All right. At this time, county attorney, how would we best dispose of this?
You need a motion to
I'll make a
motion to approve consolidating the county Medicaid transportation services with age and disability and transit services of Rockingham County.
All right, I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second by Commissioner Bass. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. All right, we're down to item C, County Manager.
All right, the next item is, I guess it would be an action item. As you're well aware, we've got a company who is looking at purchasing a small industrial building off of Highway 2. We're assisting them in several ways to help them get funding for CDBG grants for reuse. We're also looking at funding through the Rural Center for expansion for water and sewer to allow them to be able to operate. Again, it gets back to small businesses and helping them, promoting small businesses and entrepreneurship. Even though this is a small business, they're looking at starting off by hiring up to 22 employees and investing over $600,000. And that's just a starter. You know, you see some of these, and we wish them the best. We hope they do well. And I think they will, but you know, you've got to give a little nudge before they can get going. So what they're asking for basically is assistance right now to expand their drain field. Right now, our environmental health says, look, you can't operate until you've either got on your own public water and sewer, or your drain field is extended to meet the needs they need. It's going to cost about $3,500 to get their drain fields in order and to put in the grease trap. We're going to get $1,000 from the partnership to go towards it, and the county's commitment will be $2,500 to go towards the overall project to assist them if you're in favor of that, which we've talked about, trying to promote small entrepreneurship to grow. And this would be part of our match for our Rural Center grant. We got to match the Rural Center grant, and if we put in $2,500 towards this or $3,500 towards this, and that would be part of our match towards the Rural Center to get water and sewer to the building. And when the dust settles with the Rural Center, you know, if something happens, if they don't meet their demands, we've still got the water and sewer to the facility. And the reuse grants is a different scenario, which there may be some issues there, but we'll discuss that at the August the 14th meeting, which I think the public hearing scheduled for the CDBG reuse grant. But what I want to get from you all tonight is to approve the intent to provide $2,500 to fill the gap for the expansion of the drain field so that Kalo Foods can begin operations, and to approve a modification to the public hearing to receive public comment on us utilizing those funds for the expansion of the drain field.
So in effect, what you're doing is a preliminary approval. And the reason that the manager is saying that, and I'm making this comment, is you do have a public hearing requirement, but this sort of came up past the deadline for getting a public hearing scheduled for tonight. But at the same time, Mr. Metzler would like to have some direction to make sure that this is the way you want to go, if you want to fold this in. And this would also give, this expression of intent would give the company some encouragement to know this is the direction we're headed in.
Okay, I know this request is coming out of the contingency fund and $2,500. And of course, you've got where's the other $1,000 coming from?
Partnership.
Partnership's going to they're going to throw in some. Okay, great. They're going to throw in $1,000, so that takes care of that. and this is another one of these small. Companies that wanted to relocate here, a small amount of jobs, 22 jobs. And when you're looking at 22 jobs, hey, it ain't 220, but it's 22 people that somebody can carry a check home to. Commissioner Travis, you have a comment?
This is another point I was just trying to make. I'd like to thank Lance and the staff for finally getting with this company. But I want to make sure everybody understands, with the Rural Center grant, we would have to give $3,500, for an incentive to match them. So, with them wanting to use a septic tank to build their septic tank, I think they've already got in touch with North Carolina Rural Center, and they agreed that we could do that, right? So I'm all for it. Let's go ahead and do it. This is another example of what Lance and his staff is trying to do, is give the small man a leg up. And I'm all for it. It's another way of thinking outside the box and not doing a traditional approach. Baby steps, Lance. One-stop shop, baby.
Okay, Commissioner Bash, comment, questions?
Just a comment. Again, Mr. Manager, I appreciate your efforts, and you have my full support. Thank you.
Commissioner Kellum?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Manager, I fully understand what we're doing. Anytime that we can create jobs and opportunity in our county at this level and with this less money, then I think it's something we need to definitely look at. You have my support.
Need a motion?
Okay. Well, at this time, I'd rather the attorney, our attorney, give us the text, because it's complicated with the public hearing issue.
Okay, well, it's a motion to approve the manager's recommendation. You can just go that far, but more fully, that the $3,500 for a septic upgrade be included in the county's match to our building upfit application.
Can I feel that satisfied our requirements?
Just a tiny item.
Lester. Thank you, Chairman. Bill Lester with Hobbs Up Church. The $3,500, you said building upfit, it's actually for the water and sewer improvements to the Rural Center. Yeah. And we do have to publish a notice for the second public hearing for the CDBG part of the water and sewer. And in that public hearing notice, we can say where all of the money is coming from.
Combine both of those, that would be the direction.
It's part of the required notice procedures with the CDBG program, to announce it in the paper, what you're doing, who you're serving, and where the money's coming from. So if that covers that, sure, we'll provide that for the county's review before publishing.
I'll make that motion.
All right.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. right, motion's been made for approval as stated by our county attorney. Do I have a second?
I second it, please.
I have a motion and a second for approval as stated by our county attorney. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed likewise. And if you would, I've had a request for about a 5 minute break. Let's take one.
I'll make that motion.
For the body's sake. Let's take all right. Let's call a meeting back to order, please, here at about 20 to 9. And County Manager, you've got one more item, and then we'll get to Ms. Galloway.
Yeah, I've got just two appointments. First is for Center Point, Larry Johnson, Deanna Lawson, and Ron Norwood. Their term expired on June 30, 2012. The Center Point Human Services Board of Directors, Center Point has included a letter in your agenda that asks that you all consider reappointing these individuals for another 3-year term, which will take from June 30th, 2015.
Okay, is there any questions, comment?
I got one.
Okay, Commissioner Travis?
Ms. Lawson, how many terms have you been on this board?
Oh, I've just been on just recently
because I just feel so much. Thank you, not further.
Okay, is there any other comments, questions?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
If it's appropriate at this time, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the reappointments as stated within the request.
I second.
Okay, I have a motion made by Commissioner Callum, second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Now we're down to Ms. Galloway.
I've got one more appointment.
Word.
It's the voting delegation. Delegate designation, the Association of County Commissioners Annual Conference is coming up August 16th to the 19th. As you know, they need to have you all designate a voting delegate to serve. We have Chairman May, Vice Chairman Kellum, and Commissioner May that will be attending, Commissioner Bass that will be attending the conference. Actions requested for you all to appoint a delegate to serve on behalf of Rockingham County.
Can it be anybody?
All right.
Three.
Wow. I'll make a motion for Keith to be a delegate. Keith May.
Got a motion that the chair be the voting delegate. Do I have a second?
You have a second, sir.
I have a second by Commissioner Callum. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. I overlooked item two there, can't imagine. Now, Ms. Galloway.
Thank you. We have a request from the Rockingham County Historical Society Museum and Archives, to continue the $50,000 to assist them with their utility cost of the old courthouse. This was a contract that was entered into with them in August of last year. So they requested that this be extended again this year.
All right, let's see if there's any questions. And by the way, this $50,000 that we approved last year is basically if that building was empty, if the museum and all was empty and we didn't use it for a museum, the maintenance, the upkeep would be around $50,000, whether it was empty or whether somebody is going to be in it. And that's why it was a unanimous approval to approve the $50,000 and give it to them on an annual reoccurring basis, but it's voted on as a reoccurring basis. But it's strictly money that we were expected to spend anyway, whether it was empty or whether it was full. Commissioner Travis, you had a question or comment?
No, I'll just go ahead and make the motion for approval.
Okay. I have a motion for approval by Commissioner Travis. Do I have a second?
I second. I
have a second by Commissioner Callum. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed likewise? So carried. All right. County Manager, is there anything?
No new business, no closed session.
And we don't have, well, our next meeting August 14th. Here in the chambers, and our next road meeting is August 27th at Reedsville City Hall. Is what that is.
We'll make an announcement for the museum's grand opening. It was August 11th.
August the 11th is the museum's grand opening as well.
Spread the word. That's going to be pretty interesting.
So, at this time, I want to thank everybody for being here. Thank all the media for being here. Rockingham Update and Eden News. Thank you, everybody. And now, at this time, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Mr. Chair.
Second.
I have a motion made to adjourn by Commissioner Callum, second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We are now adjourned. Have a great day.